everybody, for coming to this joint IEMS IPP seminar today. We're really excited. We've been working on this one for a while, actually, to have Professor Reetika, Khera, who is an associate professor of economics and public systems group at IIM, Ahmedabad. She did her PhD at the Delhi School of Economics, her postdoctoral work at Princeton, and taught at IIT Delhi before joining IIMA. She's received fellowships from the Institute for Economic Growth, King's College London, Princeton University, and Stanford University. Professor Khera's research has shaped several policy debates around India's public services. For over 15 years, she has conducted field studies on India's public services, child care centers, school meals, public health services, etc., with a view to understanding the impact of government programs, contrast across states, and change over time. She has published widely across disciplinary genres, including in the Journal of Development Studies, Food Policy, Population and Development Review, and World Development, and is a regular contributor to Economic and Political Weekly.
So thank you for coming, and thank you especially for inviting me. I was very keen and interested in talking about Aadhaar in Hong Kong, as I was explaining to some others over lunch, because it's a national ID project which has biometrics built into it, and of course the interest in talking to people here is because I'm assuming that people here, there will be people here who know much more about the social credit system in China, which I think is very similar to what we are seeing happen in India. Of course, in India it didn't really start this way. It started as an enabler of welfare programs, something that would not only reduce corruption in the implementation of these programs, but also lead to more become a tool of inclusion of more people into the safety nets that the Indian government has. And that's exactly how I got involved in the project. Because around 2010, when discussions around this started in Indian policy circles and public debates, this is the big push that was being made. And my research, as Khera just pointed out, was really on the implementation of these programs in India, and especially looking at how corruption in these programs happens and what is the scale of corruption in these programs. So I was reasonably well suited to examine the claims that were being made by the proponents of the Aadhaar project in India. The biometric ID is called Aadhaar. And so, fortunately or unfortunately, three of the persons who were involved with that, the Indian authority charged with implementing this program, they came to meet me in 2010 to explain why Aadhaar was going to be so important for the programs that we did research on. And within 20 minutes of that conversation, it was very evident to me that they were sort of barking up the wrong tree. So I think maybe I should use the slides to some extent. So I actually got into the debate really from the welfare side of the project, but as the years passed, I was sort of forced to educate myself not only about the right to life sort of concerns that the welfare projects deal with, but also the right to privacy sort of concerns that other people have been, other people have been raising privacy related concerns with this project. So that's how I started educating myself, even with the limitations of my disciplinary training, and started reading not only legal literature around the right to privacy, but also a little bit of the critical voices within, especially computer science, on these technologies and the ways in which they endanger the right to privacy and why we should be concerned about the right to privacy at all, even in the digital age. So the bulk of what I'll do today is maybe, I think, focus on the welfare side, but I'm very happy to talk about the privacy side, especially if there's time. I'm generally used to talking about Aadhaar only to Indian audiences, so I have this problem. In any case, even in India, I have the problem of tending to assume that people know a lot. So in case you feel like you don't really know the background and you want more details, just stop and ask so that I can fill in the context. So one of the ways in which, so in the initial years, the way the proponents of this program were pitching this was something that would allow the state to fulfill its promise on the right of life side. And then when it became evident that actually, slowly there was an acknowledgement, not enough really, that you know, this right to privacy is also going to be endangered by this project, then they started pitching it as a trade-off between those two things. That, oh yes, you know, all these elite who write in the English newspapers, they are concerned about the right to privacy, but they have to let go because this project is so important to ensure the right to life of so many millions of Indians who are living in very vulnerable conditions. So that's the sort of framing of the debate that's shifted a little bit, and actually this book around which the talk is centered is basically arguing that the Aadhaar project is endangering both the right to life and the right to privacy. That it's caused damage in the implementation of these welfare programs, and I'll talk a little bit about that, and also of course on the right to privacy side, maybe towards the end if there's a little bit more time. So let's go back to this meeting with the three people who had come from the authority that was charged with implementing the program. And basically, so there are questions about the use of biometrics and the reliability of biometrics as a science, right? So I think by and large, I have tended to go along with the assumption that biometrics works really well and that this is a reliable sort of science. Although some of my friends in the Aadhaar debate are very angry with me whenever I let go of this, you know, when I concede this point to the techies or whatever one wants to call them. But let's assume that biometrics actually do work the way we think they work in popular imagination. In that case, biometrics can play a useful role in containing identity fraud. And the main form of identity fraud is the existence of duplicates. So I'm supposed to get only one pension, but I managed to enroll in two or three different villages or two or three states and somehow defraud the system and I get more than what I'm entitled to. Another form of identity fraud is when, if I'm an administrator of the program, I manage to plant some fake non-existent names, ghosts, onto the registry, onto the on the roles of these various programs. And because I'm in charge of that database or whatever it is, I'm able to use that access to swindle some money. So if biometrics work, and if Aadhaar is universal, and you actually manage to create a deduplicated database of numbers linking each person to a unique number, then you can solve the problem of identity fraud. But our own experience and documentation of fraud in these programs was suggesting that actually identity fraud was not the major problem. That there are many other forms of fraud, and as far as the total corruption is concerned, it was really those other mechanisms through which the cheating was happening. So the first question I put to these people who had come is to say, why don't you present me with some evidence on the scale of identity fraud in these programs that you're concerned about, the public distribution system, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. So just a word on these programs, the public distribution system provides access to subsidized grain to about 2/3 of the population now at very heavily subsidized prices. And the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act is a legal entitlement to work, where the government steps in as the employer of the last resort. So if people don't really have anything else going, then the government says that, I mean, at least the legal guarantee is there. It's not always respected or, you know, it's not observed on the ground. So so we said that, why don't you show us some evidence of this, the scale of identity fraud in these programs? And of course, they didn't have an answer. And for me, many years later, after years of trying to push the government on this issue and try to tell them, why don't you do studies to establish the scale of this problem before you like throw so much money and effort at it, that nothing happened. And then we were doing our little micro studies, really small samples of 3,000 people here and, you know, 500 people there. And in those studies, finding that, you know, in the survey of pensioners in 10 states, we found one case of duplication. So we basically got the list for a randomly selected bunch of villages. We got the list, official list, and then our teams went looking for each of those people, and they found one case of duplication in all of that. There is this problem of maintenance of the list, that when somebody dies, that person's name will not be struck off. But that doesn't necessarily mean fraud, because if the money was going into that person's bank account, then the bank will not let anyone else withdraw the money unless that person is there. So anyway, no evidence on the scale of identity fraud. And then many years later, I read Shoshana Magnet's book on biometrics. It's called When Biometrics Fail. And she looks at the use of biometrics in the US. And basically, I mean, in a nutshell, her argument is that when the technology was developed in the military establishment or whatever, then they started looking for commercial applications of it. And when they began to do that, because the history of biometrics is very fraught, right? It was associated with crime, it was associated with all kinds of ghastly incidents in Germany, etc. So they knew that there would be resistance to its commercial applications. So what they did is they first went to the prison industry, where they knew the rights of the concerned population were very weak in the first place. They would not be able to resist it. But even after it was applied in the prison industry in the US, the biometric industry didn't really turn a profit. And so then they set their eyes on welfare. And in welfare, the states that made it compulsory, I don't know if it still is compulsory, but there are a bunch of states in the US that made it compulsory. She says that the case for the use of biometrics was made by trumping up the problem of identity fraud. And even in those states, the lack of evidence was presented as evidence of its existence in the system. Yes, it's completely circular. But for me, it was really remarkable how the same strategy was also used in India. You keep repeating, in the US, there's this welfare queens kind of, you know, it captures the imagination of people. And in India, it was, these people have duplicates and there are ghosts in the system. And, you know, the person, one of the main persons who pushed for this project, in his book, he has a line where he says that the number of ration cards, BPL, below poverty line ration cards in Karnataka is more than the population of Karnataka. It's completely factually incorrect. And it has passed, and then this is again, of course, because it's this really important, publicly sort of eminent person writing in this book, then it becomes folklore and welfare queens, etc. So basically, the size of this problem remains by and large unknown. To the extent that there is evidence of identity fraud, it's suggesting that it's really minuscule, less than 1% or less than 2%, depending on which program and which state you're looking at. So that's why I say that it was a remedy in search of a disease, that they had a cure for duplication, and therefore they kind of trumped up that side of the problem. And I come back to the displacement effects of some of the, you know, the approach that they use. So just to give you a sense of the kind of fraud that we see, I'm just giving the example of one program, which is the public distribution system. And basically, these are the different types of fraud or corruption that exist, right? So identity fraud, you can have duplicates or ghosts. Quantity fraud is basically underselling, that when you go to the ration shop to buy your monthly grain, instead of giving you your full quota of 20 kilos, the person makes you sign off on 20 kilos, but then only gives you 18 or 10 or 5, depending on the kind, the state that you're in and your kind of power relationship with the dealer. The third one is eligibility fraud, and again, because their thinking was so muddle-headed, the proponents of Aadhaar, they felt that they could do something about eligibility as well. So what is eligibility fraud? It's basically inclusion and exclusion errors. Yeah? So actually, it's inclusion errors when you're not entitled, but you manage to get in. Either because you fudge your data, you misreport your data to the government. So you know, you're supposed to get a ration card only if you live in a mud hut, but you tell them that you actually live in a concrete house, but you tell them that you're living in Ahmedabad and you fudge your data. That's the kind of eligibility fraud. The next one is overcharging. You ask for more than the official rate. And then the last one is adulteration of the, so you know, in every 20 kilos, you might add 50 grams or for whatever, or just some rubbish, so that you're able to siphon off a little bit. And so of all these different kinds of fraud, the only one that Aadhaar can really remedy is the identity fraud part of the problem, right? Because the way they conceived the use of this biometric ID in this in these programs is they said that basically if you have 100 people entitled to PDS rations, each one will link their Aadhaar number. Anyone at the end of the time period who doesn't have an Aadhaar number linked to them will automatically be deemed a ghost or a fake and deleted from the database. Yeah, that's step one. Step two is that every month when you go to buy your rations, you will biometrically authenticate yourself. And only if your fingerprint matches, today matches your fingerprint in the system from the time that you enrolled, will you be able to get your ration. And I'll come back to that in a little while. Now, when you do monthly authentication, that doesn't fix the problem of quantity fraud, right? Because if he had the power to make you sign on 20 kilos and give you 10, then he can make you put your thumbprint in a machine reader and still do exactly the same. Yeah. So the official records will show full sale and everything is hunky-dory, but actually the ground reality is quite different. So the biometrics don't really fix the problem of the power asymmetry between the dealer and the eligibility fraud. Again, my biometrics are not going to tell the government whether I'm rich or poor. And the data that is collected by Aadhaar is actually very limited. It's just some very basic demographic details, your date of birth, address, name of parents, and that's about it. Yeah, so there's no socioeconomic information linked in the Aadhaar database that would tell them whether I'm eligible or not for this particular program, right? So as far as identity fraud is concerned, Aadhaar isn't really helpful in and of itself unless it starts getting linked to other databases that contain socioeconomic information about that individual. And then of course, similarly, the other two, Aadhaar is sort of not going to remedy these problems. So,
Is there any information on the prevalence of the other types of fraud?
That's right, okay, thanks. According to our work, the big leakage point is quantity fraud. And the quantity fraud was happening in different ways, but one important point of leakage was when you go to the ration shop and, you know, because there's no grievance redressal mechanism in place and there's no action taken against these people, basically they have a free hand, yeah? So the estimates, the corruption problem in both the Employment Guarantee Act and in the PDS was pretty bad. But if your money is going into your bank account, again, this whole Aadhaar technology is not going to help you in any case because only I can operate my bank account. Nobody else can go and operate my bank account. And to the extent that the banking system is by and large robust, that wasn't really a concern. In the PDS, at the All India level, the last estimates are from 2011-12, and according to one data source, it's still about 30% not reaching people, and according to the National Sample Survey, it's even more, it's about 42%. Yeah, but things have changed even more. I mean, already these are improved figures. It used to be much worse in 2004-05, and then after the 2011-12, at least smaller studies are suggesting that there's been further improvement. So this is how Aadhaar is supposed to work in the public distribution system. I should say something actually about eligibility for government programs, because inclusion into these programs was a big selling point for the Aadhaar project, right? And what we have been saying is that actually you have to think about eligibility into government programs as a hurdle race. That the first hurdle is that people should know what are the different programs of social support that are available. Do I qualify for this one? If I qualify, what are the supporting documents that I need to submit along with my application? The next hurdle is actually submitting that, because you know there might be some cranky person sitting there who wants to ask you for money, when he accepts your form, etc. And then if you meet the criteria and you supported, submitted all your supporting documents, then you kind of reach the finishing line. If there's still space in that program to add more beneficiaries, because the coverage of these programs is constrained by the budgets. So in a particular village, there might be 50 old people who meet all the government criteria for a pension, but those the government's cap for that village is only 40. So the remaining 10 will get put on a wait list. If it's a well-administered state, they'll get put on a wait list waiting for the, one of those 40 to die. And then you get moved on, yeah? So if there's space, if say there were 39 pensioners in that village and you were the 40th one to apply and you meet all these criteria, then you get put on. So you've kind of reached the finishing line. But what Aadhaar did then is it added three more hurdles at the finishing line. They said, okay, you've made it. Now you get enrolled into Aadhaar. You link your Aadhaar number to the registry for the pension and to your bank account. And in some cases, you also do monthly biometric authentication. So basically, the it's not really able to do anything about inclusion because the inclusion bottleneck is coming from the budget constraints. And instead, of course, it's adding these extra layers of hassle or exclusion entirely. So in the PDS, this is how it works. You do the seeding, is the linking of your Aadhaar number with your ration card or whatever. Then you go every month and there's a point of sale machine and you're supposed to put your fingerprint in the machine. This has to be real-time authentication because your fingerprint is being matched against the CID, the central repository in Bangalore or wherever it's sitting, Gurgaon, I don't know. The Aadhaar servers have to be up and running at that point of time and your fingerprint should not have changed in the interim. So you need for all of these things to work at that particular moment that you show up at the ration shop. If any one of these fails, then you're not going to get your ration on that particular day. And all of this is being done to ensure that if I am the beneficiary, then only Reetika should get this ration, right? And then the whole village standing there saying, yes, this is Reetika, but none of those forms of authentication are acceptable in this system. The other problem, this is a bit of a digression with this, is that the flexibility that was there earlier, where if I was sick and laid up in bed, then I could send my neighbor with my ration card and they would get my grains for me. That possibility is gone now, and actually that flexibility was most useful to old people who were not able to walk to the ration shop or not able to carry the load back, and somebody or the other in the village, either family or village, was helping them. That's no longer possible within the system. So obviously, because this is quite demanding in many parts of the country, not just rural, but even urban sometimes, and actually there's one server which is missing, because you need two servers to work at the same time. You need the Aadhaar server to say, yes, this is Ritika's fingerprint, but you also need the food department server to work to say that Ritika's ration card is supposed to get 10 or 20 or 30, whatever kilos, right? So both those servers are. So basically, it's very fragile technology, and we're finding very high rates of exclusion. And so what we find is that the so-called remedy is actually worse than the disease. It's not solving any of the existing problems, which was mainly quantity fraud is what we're concerned with, but to some extent even overcharging. It's not obviously not equipped to deal with the eligibility issue, but instead now it's given rise to a whole new generation of problems in the implementation. So I've already talked about this exclusion part, right? So many times when I talk about, you know, the server and the connectivity, etc., people say, no, these are teething problems, and to make an omelette, you have to break some eggs, some like really random analogies. But the problem is that even if you are able to make all of that work as it's supposed to work, what happens is that people are left exactly where they were before the integration of Aadhaar into this whole system, right? If you were being cheated of 2 kilos before, when you were signing in the register, you'll still be cheated of 2 kilos because, you know, he's, so it's pain without gain. pain for some people means you just get completely excluded because you may go today, it doesn't work, tomorrow you try again, it doesn't work. You send somebody else in the family because maybe the problem is with your fingerprint, it still doesn't work. In some cases, okay, today the child's biometric is working, so the third day you end up getting your ration. So the transaction costs have gone up for those who are still successful in getting their rations, and then there's a minority that are completely getting kicked out of these things. So I think this this idea that it's pain without gain has been very hard to get people to accept, at least in India. And then, like I said, there are some very stark cases where people have died, and that's actually a story that's worth telling. So like I said before, the government set deadlines saying you have to link your Aadhaar number with the PDS by 31st July. So this is from Jharkhand now, in 2017. And after 31st July, in August, on 15th August, which is Independence Day in India, the Chief Minister of Jharkhand, in his Independence Day speech, said Aadhaar has helped us save so many crores of rupees, because we were able to remove all these fake beneficiaries from the PDS rolls. Over a month later, on 27th September, one young 11-year-old girl died. And according to her mother's insistent that before she passed, like she slipped into unconsciousness and died, she was saying bhat bhat, which is rice, rice. So what had happened in the case of that family was that they had not been able to link their Aadhaar by 31st July, and they had been knocked off the system. And this exclusion of a legitimate beneficiary had been projected by the state government as a saving, as a benefit from Aadhaar, because they were saying that this family basically was a bogus or a fake entry in the system. Now, to what? How many of those who were bumped off, we still don't know how many were genuine beneficiaries and how many were genuinely fake. But we've also, and the book has one chapter from Rajasthan where a journalist, she documents these sorts of exclusions of old pensioners. Basically, they, if you take the list of the government, it says they are dead. And then when she went to these villages, she found them actually not thriving, but certainly alive, wondering where their pension, why their pension had been stopped in the past few months. So exclusions are being passed off as savings by the government. And then the final thing is that, you know, in the public distribution system or even in any other, the government knows very well that the point of leakage is the dealer, is the person who's delivering the benefit at the last mile. But they're unable to hold that person to account, to punish him or her or levy a fine or whatever form of punishment is there, and because they are unwilling or unable to do that, basically they're shifting the burden and sort of criminalizing the whole population by saying, now you stand on your head because we don't really have the political will to push back and put these people in jail, etc. So this this sort of inversion and passing off of the costs to poor people who are already leading rather difficult lives is another problematic aspect of this project. There is a very short film, but maybe I'll just push it to the end. It's 8 minutes long, but just to, if there's time, then we can take a look at it. I don't want to create.
Work.
It's not inside.
Thank you. Sorry. Okay. One important sort of revelation for me as part of doing research on this has been the propaganda around the project. And already, you know, at the beginning, they were packaging as this thing that would help welfare, etc. And at that point, I was not particularly interested in Aadhaar. I only got interested because they came and tried to convince me that it was going to be fantastic. But I just want to give two small examples of the kind of propaganda that surrounded this project. Both the World Bank and the Indian government have been saying that the potential for saving money by bringing efficiency into the implementation of welfare programs is massive if you integrate it with Aadhaar. So the story of the World Bank is really very interesting, and I'm glad some friends who will appreciate the story are here. So in 2016, the World Bank, it does this annual report, it's called the World Development Report, and this one was called Digital Dividends, and in that report, they had this passage. So look at the panel on the right, left, and they say of all the programs, the third line, potentially saving $11 billion per month, yeah? So when the report was released, of course, it made a big splash in the Indian media, and a friend in the media, he said, you know, there's that estimate about savings in the cooking gas subsidy that I get, but where are they getting this $11 billion figure from? So I said, okay, let me see what are the assumptions they made to arrive at this estimate. So there was a footnote, if you see there's a footnote which says Banerjee 2015, and I chased up Banerjee 2015, and what she says in her policy brief is that the Indian government's welfare budget is $11 billion. Okay, footnote 4 refers to Banerjee 2015, which says that the Indian government's budget on welfare is $11 billion. From her, total budget is $11 billion. By the time it comes into the World Bank report, it becomes potentially saved $11 billion, essentially the entire budget. So of course, we started badgering them. I wrote about it in July 2016. And then the following year, someone I work with, he wrote about it in Indian Express and Indian Daily. And actually, he named Shweta Banerjee in his article. Now, maybe she has, you know, she must have done a Google search and or whatever. She noticed that her name had appeared in this op-ed. So she got really alarmed, and she started writing to the World Bank and saying, hey, how are you misrepresenting my work? And, you know, So what did they do? After, I think Jean wrote about it once and I wrote about it twice, and then somebody else, very persistent techie in Bangalore, latched onto it, they replaced that footnote. So now you can see the first three footnotes are the same, but footnote number 11, the 4 has become really long. And so what do they say? That we were taking 10% of the welfare budget, and actually they got the welfare budget wrong. The welfare budget actually is in this range. And if you take an average of that and then you take a 10%, what you get? You get $11 billion. And so Shaw and I wrote about it in Economic Times. It was really funny. I should have actually got a screenshot of that. Whoever the editor is or in charge of that page, around the op-ed, he's got like a little panel of 12 different yoga postures. So basically, it was quite cleverly done. I don't know how many people latched on to it, but we certainly had a good laugh. And you know, this range is totally is wrong, because the stuff, these centrally sponsored schemes, etc., that they mentioned, includes the government spending on environment, dairy farming, animal husbandry, like everything now has become welfare spending. Yeah? So basically, they were just trying to retrofit and save face, rather than apologizing, say, you know, that we made a mistake or whatever it is. So this is as far as the World Bank's propaganda is concerned. The Indian government, of course, is as bad. And mainly the problem is that when they strike off names, all of it is passed off as ghosts, when in fact there are just some people who failed or were unable to link their other numbers. So, you know, the finance minister in this financial, previous financial year, just before the budget, he again endorsed the World Bank figure, which has been trashed a number of times, but also said that they had saved, the government keeps saying that we have removed bogus job cards in the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. And you can see from parts B and C, these are answers in Parliament, that from B and C they ask what are the details of savings expected, and they say the question does not arise. So in Parliament they're actually still saying the truth, but again the press releases and the statements in the public are actually completely different from what is being reported to Parliament. So you know, for a lot of Indian people, for the public, you know, they say that, well, you know, Aadhaar is saving so much money, what are you people talking about? And it's been quite important to tell them that actually you just cannot accept these things at face value. And we're lucky that at least in Parliament, somebody admitted that, you know, there was, the cancellations were not due to Aadhaar, they were due to different reasons. And in any case, therefore, the question of savings doesn't arise. I'm going to skip this one because this is just a jibe at some of the economists who, sitting afar, have been creating more troubles. But basically, the theme is the same. But so finally, I don't know how long I was supposed to speak. Yeah. Okay. I didn't want to spend time sort of demolishing the right to life, welfare side of the story, because many people still believe in it, and many people certainly bought into it at that time in India. The other side, which is the right to privacy side, which is something that I had to kind of educate myself. I was also like, you know, what is this privacy? What do I care? Let somebody else deal with it. I'm not really trained or equipped to think about these issues. But I've been having really tortured conversations with computer scientist colleagues. I used to be at the Indian Institute of Technology. And every time we said privacy, he was hearing data security. And this annoyed me to no extent. Because I'm like, no, even I know that the right to privacy is not just about protecting the data. And its leakage is much more than that. So then, by the by, I kind of got involved. And I think for me, the subtitle of the book is Big Data Meets Big Brother. And it's really to hint at that the actual, this project was never about welfare. It was always about the data mining possibilities in this kind of digital world. That kind of data mining is possible even if you don't have a national ID kind of program, a number that is seeded into every single database in the country. But when it is seeded into every single database in the country, what you're essentially doing is creating a bridge across all these different data silos, which allow whoever has access to this to create a 360-degree profile of your life. So the work of, I don't know if Arvind Narayanan, okay, so there's a computer scientist at Princeton called Arvind Narayanan. He works on privacy. He's a computer scientist. So thankfully, finally, my IIT Delhi colleague had to listen and give in. So yes, if Arvind Narayanan is saying it, there must be something to it. So he says that even when data is anonymized, if you link up many different data sets, these techniques and tools have advanced so much that you can de-anonymize the data. So this idea of personally identifiable information has become slightly redundant and needs to be re-looked at. But what Aadhaar is doing, and this is again now coming from the work of Bruce Schneier, who must be here, he says that with the rise of the digital economy, one other thing that's happened is the rise of data brokers. And what do the data brokers do? They get a little bit of data from here, a little bit of data from there, and then using these techniques, either they combine it together, and it has great value for what Bruce Schneier calls corporate surveillance, which is micro-targeting, basically. And then, of course, governments are interested because of the state surveillance, the possibilities of state surveillance, disciplining populations, etc., etc. The other thing that I just talked with, I found all these books extremely useful in trying to understand the big picture, so I think it's worth sharing that joy with other people. So the other really good scholar is Daniel Sotoff, who is a legal scholar in the US, and he's been thinking about privacy in this kind of information digital age, and he has one really nice paper where he says that the good metaphor for databasing is not Big Brother, not Orwell's Big Brother, but Kafka's trial. He said this is because with Big Brother, you know the evil intent, that there is this intent to discipline, control, etc. But with a lot of these databasing projects, the intent is not necessarily evil. These techies who were working on the project, I mean, in the initial years, they didn't know where the problem lay, but they thought, you know, we're going to get rid of the problem. I mean, they should have learned after they were warned. They didn't learn. That's another question. So he says, because these technologies have this approach of fitting a grid on a society that is not fittable into a grid, what happens is that some people fall off the grid. And if this time in the discussion, I can give the example of pensions and how, you know, this is very... And then the other aspect that he talks about is the powerlessness and disempowerment that comes with this kind of centralizing technology. So in Kafka's trial, this chap, he doesn't know what he's been tried for, when the judges are going to sit, what he should do to clear his name. He does, so, you know, he's basically left in the dark. There's some machinery up there that's controlling what happens with his life, but he really can't, he doesn't have agency anymore to fix. And this is exactly what Aadhaar is doing to a lot of people. Suddenly the pension stops. They have no idea why the pension has stopped. They don't know how to fix it. They don't know who to go to, because even the person at the last point, the bank official, they don't know anything about the UID, the Aadhaar infrastructure, right? They say you go talk to the biometric ID people who are administering that, because the problem lies there. And they, of course, don't exist at the village level. They only exist on the cloud. So this disempowering effect of these sort of databasing technologies, or whatever you want to call it. And then the final thing that I wanted to talk about, I mean, I'm sure people are now familiar with Cathy O'Neill's work. Okay, so she's a mathematician who worked with Dee Shaw and used to teach math at Barnard College before she became what she became. But she talks about how algorithms are black boxes, lack accountability, and have biases built into them. I think there's quite a lot of literature on this, so it doesn't, I mean, Cathy O'Neill is like the most popularly read book. And so she documents how in different sectors in the US, these are being used in ways that end up hurting the poor and increasing inequalities, right? So as far as job searches are concerned, education loans, online lending, and many other sectors. And one of the things which is, she also talks about how it's used to extract consumer surplus. And one example which really does catch my imagination is the Uber example, where Uber was able to, when you download the Uber app, apparently there was a time when they were also accessing your hardware information, which included the battery charge on your phone. And basically what they were then doing is, if your battery charge was low when you were ordering a taxi, they would do surge pricing. Mm-hmm. And with the assumption that if your battery is low, you just take whatever you're getting, right? So you can charge a higher price. Then of course they got out and they had to stop doing it, but that to the extent that they're able to do it, some people are doing it. And then Virginia Eubanks is, last, I'm going to really be quiet after this. Virginia Eubanks talks about the use of technology in the US welfare system, and she basically says that through the 60s and 70s, I don't know the US case that well, but as these women's movements, etc., started getting legal victories for improved entitlements, and started applying, mobilizing and applying to get more, and the budget started rising, the state's response was to throw technology at them. So for one example was that now all applications had to be made online. There was no other way to do it. And so obviously for black women who didn't have access to computers and internet, etc., it had to be mediated. So it increases the costs of getting access to these programs. So it's not a database kind of thing. It's more a few case studies that she follows, but it's quite nicely done. So basically all over the world, it seems to be that technology enjoys this very positive, rose-tinted. People have a very rose-tinted view of technology, and if you question technology, then you're immediately labeled a Luddite. Even though there is obviously enough documentation of some of the flip sides and also some of its devious use. I mean, sometimes it's just not intended, but sometimes it may even be intended. And I feel that's why the Aadhaar project has been sort of educative for me also. Just finally about Aadhaar, coming back from this thing to Aadhaar again. One other very worrying aspect of the program has been how it undermined almost every democratic process. So they passed the bill by classifying it as a money bill, which meant that they didn't have to seek approval of the upper house. Before that, when in the previous government's term, when the parliamentary standing committee shot down the bill and told them that actually you haven't even thought through this project, it was completely ignored. The Supreme Court, poor thing, they've been ordering again and again since 2013, saying you can't make it compulsory, but nobody cares. Like, even the software has been tweaked so that people can't even apply if they don't submit their Aadhaar numbers. And we have screenshots, but again, the court was not particularly bothered. And then now when the Supreme Court so there was a big litigation in the Supreme Court. Actually, Aadhaar has been fantastic because it also got us the right to privacy judgment. And there are lawyers and they would be really interested in that. But in September 2018, the Supreme Court said, we're going to allow its use for government programs, but not its use by private entities. So they struck down the section of the act that allowed private entities to ask for your Aadhaar number. And the government's response has been to bring an amendment which does remove that section, but then it amends two other previous acts of the government which basically bring the same provisions back and allow private entities. They were not able to pass that act in the winter session of parliament, and what did they do? A few days later, they passed an ordinance to resurrect those provisions. And similarly, the authority in charge of Aadhaar, the UIDAI, has also been eroding the various autonomous institutions, and the Reserve Bank, the Central Bank of India, has been one of the entities that's been hit, because if you go and talk to them about Aadhaar and the banking system, because they're supposed to be overseeing the banking system, they said, don't ask us to go to UIDAI. So basically, UIDAI is now issuing direct orders to Indian banks saying you must enroll so many people, and if you don't enroll, then we'll penalize you in some way or the other. So I think it is a hugely problematic program in the Indian context, but possibly in other contexts as well. It is being pushed in several African countries. Quite interestingly, 4 days ago in Kenya, the court said you cannot make it mandatory. This is exactly the same as the Indian trajectory. And also, yeah, so I think it's worth many more people applying their minds to some of these issues. Thank you.
One thing it reminded me of when you're talking about there's a solution looking for a reason is like the voter fraud things in the United States. Although that's even more than first, because they're actually trying to disenfranchise people. That's kind of the purpose of them. In this case, I think they are not being too disingenuous in the sense that they probably believe that their rhetoric to some extent that this can actually improve. And I can actually think of examples where it might. If you have to bring ID to get your benefit, and now you have the Aadhaar process, then for people who like lost their IDs and had difficulty, now that's not going to be a problem for them, right? Because they'll still be able to go. Or if someone somehow stole someone's ID and then took it and whatever. So I'm just playing devil's advocate a little bit. And the problem is we really don't know the quantity of any of these cases. Recognize that there could be these other cases where it could actually improve targeting. I mean, other than just fraud, identity is just some practical reasons that once you are in, then it's actually really.
I'll respond to that. Should I collect a few questions?
Yeah, first few.
And thanks for this overview, really interesting. Clearly digital IDs are not a quick fix and come with all sorts of ethical complications. So what are the policy alternatives to the intended purpose of our part? Or has that discourse about policy alternatives been completely squashed in the course of these criticisms?
Thank you, Professor. My question is like how people perceive this when you talk to them in your media, of course. I'm indirectly associated with this because my mother is a school teacher. So we went to house to connect the data. So when something goes wrong, they can come into my mother. So the issue was, that time was, things were going wrong. Like, that mistake, the photo will be someone else, and the name will be somebody else.
Yes.
So those things, that was one concern. Second is that the proponents of Aadhaar card, they always mention national security. So I just want to know how people perceive this.
Yeah, okay. Let me start with that one because that's also been something that's given me courage. So in the initial year, I started pretty early questioning this project 2010. There were just four or five of us and everyone thought we were like cranky aunties or uncles or whatever it is. But at that time when I would talk at universities or write in the newspapers, I always got angry responses. Some very unpleasant responses. But in the past 4 years, it's changed dramatically. When I write, random people from really, like, I don't know how they get my email ID or phone number, and they call me up and they say, you're saving our lives, and actually you raised only these 10 issues, but actually there are these 6 others, and you should raise these as well. So I think as its use has spread and people have had to use it themselves, they're beginning to see that there is a problem, and the narrative that is being pushed through the media is not really what's happening on the ground. So I certainly, for me, it's become much easier to talk critically about Aadhaar now than it was before, even though the trolls are more vicious now than they were before. This national security, I think, is basically something that at least the Indian government throws at anyone who raises any critical question is a way of shutting people up. So, theek hai, let them. What the dogs bark and whatever. As far as policy alternatives are concerned, so this is something I get asked quite often. I think there are two things. One is that a compulsory Aadhaar is very different from a voluntary Aadhaar. So if the government says that it is going to be a valid ID document just like any other in the past, and if you want to apply for the PDS, you can either bring your job card or your ration card or your whatever, or your birth certificate or all these other things, or Aadhaar, then Aadhaar would be a very different beast than what it is today. But the fact is that the corporate interest and perhaps even state interest will immediately die if the compulsion goes away and the coercion goes away. And this is sort of recognized in some of the books, at least one book that has been written with a very pro-Aadhaar tilt, where they say very clearly in chapter 4 that we're giving this ID, the ID doesn't bring any benefits, so we have to create the push for the pull. And we have to create an impression in people's minds that if they don't get Aadhaar, then this or that or the other will go away. That the existing benefits will go away. So that's one, the compulsory versus voluntary thing. The other thing is that I think unique IDs are very useful for the administration of these programs. But I don't think it's particularly useful to have one overarching ID. Right? So you need a unique ID for the housing program for all those who will apply for that housing program. And you need a unique ID for all those who are enrolling in school. Right? So within data silos, there is a lot of efficiency to be gained from unique IDs. But if you do an overarching unique ID of this sort, then you bring the costs go up tremendously in terms of surveillance and privacy, etc., without necessarily bringing too many gains in terms of efficiency in delivering of goods. Yeah? So, and I think that move had already started happening. So in the past decade, before Aadhaar, computerization of welfare programs was beginning to happen, and the gains were very evident for people to see. I mean, the leakage rates in the public distribution system declined quite dramatically. So I think for me, unique IDs, but distinct data silos, like one for health, one for education, one for housing, one for rations, is fine. Because often these constituencies may not overlap. Right, so the person who's getting a housing may not necessarily be in the pension scheme. And so, you know, that's why I'm saying that the benefits are going to be possibly marginal, but the gains can be cashed in as much by having distinct silos. There's been an interesting debate about centralized health IDs in Australia, I think recently, where the government there was basically asking to store electronic health records in a central server. And there was a big discussion around privacy, because if you put everything in one place, then the data security concerns also arise. And I think France has a great solution to it. They reap the benefits of electronic health records, but they store them on smart cards which are carried by the person herself. Right? So if I go to a doctor, I carry my records, and if she plugs it into the card reader, then she's able to download these things. So the portability of health records is there, which is exactly what they want to do with digitization. But you're not creating a honeypot for people to attack. Yeah. So that's my kind of partial response to that question. And then on this, so you know the Aadhaar system, if I get into the Aadhaar system, and then I lose my Aadhaar card, and I show up at the ration shop, I do need to have the number. Because the technology does not allow for one on N matching at the time of authentication. It only allows for one on N matching at the time of enrollment. So when I enroll into Aadhaar, they will match my biometrics with everyone else who already exists in the system. And if there's no match, then I get a unique number. But when I use that unique number, the lost unique number, and try to go and authenticate myself at the bank or post office or whatever it is, if I don't have the number, then I can't say that now I'm presenting my fingerprint, now you do this one on N match, because that N is very large, right? So the kind of benefit that you're perceiving is not implementable on the ground. You said this disenfranchisement, that's actually very important, because function creep has been a very important aspect of the Aadhaar project. It started as something that was for welfare. Then they said, okay, now mobile phones and bank accounts have to be linked. Then they said it's for national security, so we'll use it for whatever. PAN cards, thank you. And now they are trying to, there was an attempt in 2015 to link it with the voter database. And very recently, in Telangana, in one of the southern states, there was a state election. And thankfully, the one thing that really helped the Aadhaar debate has been the PAN card linking and the mobile linking, because now the fire spread to the homes of the privileged. And so then suddenly they started kind of panicking, like, why do you need to put Aadhaar to get a SIM, a mobile SIM? And I'm like, yeah, this is exactly what we were saying about the PDS. Here you believe there is no identity fraud, and why do you believe that there is identity fraud? This is where the propaganda comes in. So the voter linking in India, luckily for us, what happened in that state of Telangana, two of the people whose names were wrongly knocked off happened to be very prominent citizens. One, she's a badminton player, Jwala Gutta, and a national awardee. She immediately made a video and tweeted it out. And the other person who was affected was an Indian police service officer. And again, he was obviously really annoyed by what had happened. So it became a big issue. So this disenfranchisement is happening or will be attempted if it hasn't already happened, and they're not kind of pushing back constantly. Function creep or cancer, as I like to call it sometimes, is very much a feature of this this project. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, about the social security number in the US, and of course the HKID here. When I was in the US, of course, that time there was no biometrics associated.
Still there's no biometrics.
Oh, okay. So, but I think HKID has biometrics.
I think it's a thumbprint.
Yeah, it's a thumbprint.
Yeah, because
every
access is nice.
Yeah, but I don't know. What are your thoughts in the way? inspired by social security system in the US and so on.
And that's that. Should I take more?
I think this is our last batch.
Yay. Simon always asks hard questions.
So I haven't looked at this very closely, but there was a state of Aadhaar report, which I think perhaps every year. The 2018 one did a survey of, I think, 3,000 people. And actually, the respondents were quite positive about Aadhaar, if I remember correctly. I think maybe like 80-85% said that they supported linking welfare benefits to Aadhaar. And one of the reasons cited was that it made it harder for their benefits to be diverted elsewhere. So I'm wondering if that survey was a surprise to you or if it was flawed.
Okay, so good. It gives me an opportunity to talk about the one aspect which I didn't touch on. But quickly on the SSN. So in the book, there's a chapter by a law student, and she compares the social security number with Aadhaar and lays out all the different ways why Aadhaar is not like the social security number. One, of course, is trivial that there's no biometrics in the social security number. Interestingly, they rejected, it was proposed several times, and they rejected even the inclusion of the photograph because they said it will be an administrative nightmare because you'll have to keep updating the yeah, so that's one broad reason why it's not like SSN. The other thing is she compares the Aadhaar Act with the privacy laws in the US, and she finds that there's a stark contrast in that aspect. But to the extent that Aadhaar is being pushed more and more to become like the social security number, I think it's really useful to see what happened with the Equifax data leak in 2017 and several times before that as well. So, you know, this kind of linked across databases, it does open the door to identity fraud, and then it has the domino effect, right? One thing gets compromised and somebody accesses that and gives them access to much more about you. So keeping just a simple computer science principle, you keep it decentralized, that's a big security protection in the design architecture of the system. State of Aadhaar report. So I've made many non-friends in the course of this debate. The State of Aadhaar report is funded by Omidyar Network. And Omidyar is actually funding other research as well, including ISB on Aadhaar. Omidyar is very heavily invested in fintech. Fintech technologies ride heavily on digital IDs to do the kind of credit rating in the new age using new sources of data which are not regulated by older laws. So in the older laws, you know, they would have access to some of your banking transactions, and on the basis of those things, they could do your credit rating. But with mobile phones, the potential to do credit scores using the usage of the mobile phone itself apparently has increased. So there's a really nice explainer of Privacy International on that. So clear conflict of interest. They have billions of dollars, in fact, sunk now because the Supreme Court struck down private access. And it's really those lobbies, not Omidyar Network themselves particularly, but a whole bunch of them who have been pressurizing the government to bring the ordinance. So the State of Aadhaar report was done by people who were funded by Omidyar Network. And I think the big problem there was that the fact that Omidyar had funded them affected the framing of their research. And I had been invited to the launch of the report. Because they got called out. So initially they were trying to do the launch of the report with all their people, and then they got called out on Twitter by Gautam Bhatia, who's a lawyer and, you know, has been following the Aadhaar debate. Really fine new age legal mind, and it was a big embarrassment for them. So then they started asking the other lobby to also participate. So their report, I think it suffered from the fact that they hadn't really asked the interesting questions. And that the way the questions were framed also make their interpretation a little bit difficult. And because I'm not prepared, I can't give you the good example of how they asked the wrong question and therefore got meaningless kind of answers. So and the other thing that I do remember about the support, is one of the things that the report finds is that people were using the analog version, not the digital version. Right? And the whole sell of the Aadhaar was also that this was, you know, your ID walks with you, you don't have to be worried about losing your papers, etc. None of that is actually happening on the ground, and that's not really the most widely used feature of the Aadhaar IP project. So for me, the State of Aadhaar report of 2018 wasn't particularly insightful, although they did document failures as well. In fact, they have some huge, like 10 to 15% biometric failures that they document in the report. But again, I feel that because of where the research is coming from, I feel like I have to double check everything before, whether good or bad, I feel like I want to double check everything. But there is a framing problem in that report. The questions they ask, so they're not like, what is the problem in the public distribution system, and then can Aadhaar fix this problem? They go straight to, is Aadhaar good for the PDS? Yeah. And now for a person who's sitting in the village, they may not necessarily be able to make all these connections, right? So there is some disjoint between the, like the, there should be a logical sequence to asking these questions, which was missing in the.
Radhika has left one copy of the study in the book with our institute, so people who want to borrow it, I'm not sure if it's available online, maybe not.
No.
Feel free to get in touch with us, and we can arrange for you to borrow it.
Security, then you have frictions, things not talking to each other.